Gwynn's Island. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
We're going to start with one of the early proclamations regarding it being a Christian is Jesus is Lord. And so we're going to sing He's the Lord of the Sky, Lord of the Sea. The words are in your program. Lord of the Sky, Okay, start again. He's the Lord of the sky, he's the Lord of the sea, he's the Lord of you, he's the Lord of me, and he died on the cross just to give us liberty. He's the Lord of all. Jesus is Lord, alleluia. Jesus is Lord, alleluia. Jesus is Lord, alleluia. He's the Lord of all. Yeah. Having a challenging morning this morning. How's yours?
It's Easter.
It's Easter.
It's Easter.
We do have an announcement. Friday we're having the celebration of life service for Jamie Callis. And so it'll be at the church, 10 o'clock visitation, if you want to stop in and chat with the family. 11 o'clock will be the service, 12 o'clock will be lunch, and if you want to help with the lunch, bring salads, cold stuff, cupcakes, and cookies. How about that? Actually, I remembered it. We're going to sing Christ the Lord is Risen today. We're going to sing the first verse, and then I'm going to try to play it on guitar, and then we're going to sing the second verse. The words are in your bulletin.
I'd just like to thank Pastor Ed and Mr. Tyrone for making this available to me and making it work. So just thank you.
Thank you.
troubles come and my heart burden be, then I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be.
Is he gone? Oh. Sorry about that, folks. We got some kind of technical difficulty going up here. I don't know if our amplifier is trying to quit on us or what. Ed's gone to his garage to get something else. In the meantime, this has come back on, so...
How about we have him sing one more time? Ask him to sing one more time.
Will you repeat?
Would Hunter like to come up and do that song again? Up to you.
Yeah, we need that again.
We'll try it anyway. If it quits, we'll quit. All right.
All ready for you again, I think.
All right, I'll just say thank you again, and thank you to Pastor Ed and Mr. Tyrone for letting me do this and making this work and just making it how it is, I guess. I don't know.
You raise me up to walk on stars.
market. Is it? Yep. All right, folks, the only thing I can figure going on here this morning is this young man's voice is so powerful we can't handle it. And I tell you what it does, it gets me off the hook because I'm not going to sing following that because the system is obviously not going to take it. So we're going to let Ed do his preaching sermon and hopefully we get through it. I think it's a disaster.
What do you think?
I think it'd be great.
Huh?
I think it'd be fine.
Stay with me.
I think you gotta sing.
Okay.
I talked him into singing.
Alright. Oh, yep. Oh, yeah. You're on.
Alright. The preacher man, more affectionately known as Pastor Ed, learned this song for me. I found this song about a year ago and couldn't find music for it to sing. So he says, I'll do it. So he learned the song, so he and I have got it worked out pretty decent. I'm gonna dedicate this song to Jamie White, Jamie Callis, who left us this week, unfortunately. I think that's about it.
The sermon, basically what you've been experiencing is a sermon illustration orchestrated by God, because the sermon topic is God's the God of second chances. So that's what we're working on. You lay it down on the ground or something. See if that one's working.
Check.
Check. Move that up.
Check. Check. All right. Ooh, what a morning.
Oh, Lord, what a morning.
Oh, Lord, what a morning. Sinners still ashamed. them all the same when his days on earth were through. He gave it all that he could give. So it's no surprise that he died the same way that he lived. He hung there from a cross with his arms wide open, that not one soul would be lost. He turned the other cheek when they nailed him to a tree with his arms wide open. He rescued you and me with his arms wide open. Set this whole world free with his arms wide open. He bought out eternity. There came a kind and gentle man from a town called Galilee.
Yes.
So, the second chance. Only God could orchestrate, you know, that kind of sermon illustration when the sermon was already done. Our text for today is 3. And so I'm going to read them all together, I guess, and then we'll go through the message. First is Matthew 26, 74 through 75. And it's Peter in the courtyard and denying Jesus. Then he began to call down curses and he swore to them, "I don't know the man." Immediately a rooster crowed. Then Peter remembered the word Jesus had spoken. "Before the rooster crows, you will disown me 3 times. And he went outside and wept bitterly. Then we jump to Mark 16 and Mary outside the tomb. She looked in and the angel said, "Don't be alarmed. You're looking for Jesus of Nazarene who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they've laid him. Go tell his disciples and Peter." Go tell his disciples and, oh, by the way, Peter too. "He is going ahead of you into Galilee, and there you will see him, just as he told you." And then we fast forward. Jesus manifests himself to several groups of people and different people. And the fishermen got to Galilee before Jesus, apparently. At least they thought they did. Not really, but they thought they did. And so Simon says, you know, he's depressed, and they're all kind of gloomy and depressed. And he goes, "I'm going fishing." And so they went out that night fishing. All night. Tried everything they could, and they caught nothing. And we pick up, they're coming back with empty nets, tired, exhausted, depressed. And they saw Jesus on the shore. And Jesus invited them to breakfast. First he said, "Hey guys, catch any fish?" And he knew the answer was no. And then he said, cast your net on the right side of the boat. Second chance, right? out all night, didn't catch anything. Oh, by the way, cast your net out now. And they pulled in a huge catch of fish. So they see Jesus on the shore, and they realize it's him. Peter jumps in the water, beats the boat back to shore. Jesus invites him to eat. He's already got fish on the fire. He caught fish. He's got fish on the fire. The bread's ready. He invites him to eat. And when they finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" Maybe it's the fish. Maybe it's all the things you've been going through. Simon said, "Yes, Lord, you know I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my lambs." Again, Jesus said, "Simon, John Jr., son of John, do you love me?" And he answered, "Yes, Lord, you know I love you." Jesus said, "Take care of my sheep." The third time he said to Simon, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" And Peter was hurt because the Lord asked him a third time. And he said, "Lord, you know all these things. You know that I love you." And Jesus said, "Feed my sheep." "Verily, truly, I say to you," Jesus said to Peter, "when you were younger, you dressed yourself and you went where you wanted to go. But when you're old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will dress you. And someone else will lead you where you do not want to go." Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. Then he said to him, "Follow me." And Peter turned and saw John, the other disciple. And he says, "What about him?" And Jesus said, "You don't worry about him. You follow me." Let's pray. Father, help us to be awed by how you give us second chances over and over. Thank you for your patience. Thank you for your love. Thank you for the opportunity to follow you and serve you. Help us to catch the full meaning. In Jesus' name, amen. Out here, usually taking the coats off. So, have you ever blown it? And then the person you disappointed gave you a second chance? How important was that? How did it make you feel? Have you ever had somebody betray you or hurt you, and you gave them a second chance? How'd that make you feel? But Jesus told the disciples that all of them would fall away. And Jesus was to be betrayed and arrested that very night. He said, "You're going to betray me, you're going to fall away, but after I've risen, I will go to Galilee." And Peter said, "Even if everybody else falls away, I won't, Lord." And initially he didn't, you know, because when they came to arrest Jesus, Peter pulled out his sword and whacked off one of the guy's ears. And Jesus told him to put his sword away and picked up the ear and put it back on the guy. So he started off keeping his word, but he ended up denying him. The other disciples said the same thing. "We shouldn't be so hard on Peter." All the rest of them said the same thing. "Yeah, we'll never do it. Like, we'll never betray you. We'll never fall away." Peter had a threefold denial of knowing Jesus. It's found in Matthew 26. 57 through 68. And they arrested Jesus, took him to the courtyard, and took him inside for the Sanhedrin to interrogate him and beat him up and mock him and pound his face. And soldiers put a crown of thorns on him and all that kinds of fun stuff. So Peter followed, Peter and John, and they're out in the courtyard. And this servant girl approaches Peter and says, "You're one of the Galileans too." And Peter looked at her and says, "I don't know the man. I don't know what you're talking about." So he left that area and moved a little further out. Standing there, another woman saw him and told everybody there, "See that guy over there? Hey, you really are one of those. I can tell because you speak like a Nazarene." Peter denied it, went a little further out. Finally, the people were standing around and they said, "You really are one of them. Your accent gives you away." Characteristics, Galileans had a characteristic accent, kind of like Guinea. I mean, not the same accent as Guinea, but people that know the Guinea accent, they can hear it when they hear someone speaking. And they did the same thing with Peter. I remember when we were in Hungary as missionaries, Annika spoke Hungarian really well, but she had an American accent, which we didn't, we didn't know we had an accent, but she would call this one hotel to make reservations, and it could have been a year later, and she calls, and they go, "Oh, it's the American from Seged. How are you doing?" They could tell by her accent. And so accents give you away. And so these people knew that Peter was from Galilee. So he denies Christ three times. When Peter got his life turned around, he was back ready to follow Jesus again. What turned his life around? The resurrection of Jesus. Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Salome, went with spices to the tomb. There was a large stone there, then rolled away. They went in, saw an angel dressed in white. They said, "Who are you looking for?" And then he said, "I know, you're looking for Jesus of Nazareth who was crucified. He's not here. He's risen from the dead. And he's going to go before you into Galilee, just as he said." In John 21, several things happened to show Peter that God was giving him a second chance. By telling them to go tell Peter that he's going, it meant that Jesus wanted Peter to be there. So from Peter's perspective, it's everything's okay. He included me in the invitation. Tell Peter to go to Galilee with the group. He fished all night, caught nothing. Jesus showed up, gave him a second chance to cook, catch and fish. Jesus fed him breakfast. Jesus took him aside. And then he asked him the three questions. "Do you love me?" And of course he did that three times. Why? Because he denied him three times. And he just needed to affirm him three times, just to kind of cancel everything out. It was the second chance. A chance to be restored. A chance to be affirmed by Jesus. Jesus, whom he still loved. And Jesus, who still loved him. And so really, that's what Easter is about. It's second chances. And I'm not going to go into all of them, but just think about it for a minute. When sin entered into the world, before sin entered into the world, God created the heavens and the earth. And it was good. And everything was beautiful. And God came and walked in the garden and talked with Adam and Eve. every day they would walk and have fellowship. There were no barriers, there was no fear, there was no, oh no, it's God. There was no, oh, I gotta go meet God. Hi, bird. There was none of that. It was beautiful. And then sin entered into the world. And the whole Old Testament's about that. How he selected a people that could be representative people and would have a second chance, that they could know God and they could walk with God and they could show God to other people. And that was Israel, and Israel blew it. And they tried really hard, but human flesh can't meet the standards of God. But God wanted to have a new heaven and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. He wanted to take his full circle back to the created order that God had determined from the foundations of the world. So the world was getting a second chance when Jesus came, because that would inaugurate the new kingdom of God in which righteousness dwells, and that would start in motion the time when the second coming would come, and Jesus creates a new heaven and new earth in which righteousness will dwell. So it's all God has always been about the second chance. When Israel failed, then what happened? The Messiah came to establish a new kingdom that included any of Israel that believed and any non-Israelis that believed. Because it was faith in Jesus that gave you righteousness, and it was faith in Jesus that gave you eternal life, and it's faith in Jesus that gives you, that is the second chance, which gives you everything that comes with the second chance. A lot of times it's interesting here, because Peter was told that God's not done with you yet. And, you know, we blow it, and we feel like God will throw us away, and that God's done with us. That's it. But God's not done with us yet. If you're still here, God's not done with you yet. And so it's that time where you face God and you say, I'm here for a purpose. And Jesus is trying to iterate that purpose. Take care of my lambs. Feed my lambs. Hang out with my lambs. Lead my lambs. Us, the people of God. Include more people in the people of God. Invite them to be a part of the new creation. And it doesn't just end there. If you're still here, you still have a mission. And that's what Peter was telling Peter. Jesus was telling Peter, you still have a mission. And Peter wanted to compare, you know, because Jesus says, you know, when you used to be really strong-willed, you did your own thing, you just did whatever you wanted. But when you're old, you're going to have to submit. And you're going to find that things are bigger than your capacity to control. And God's going to lead you to some places that you probably don't want to go. And the scripture says he was talking about the way Peter would die. Traditionally, it said that Peter, they were going to crucify him like Jesus. But he didn't feel worthy. And so he said, crucify me, but hang me upside down. Because I'm not worthy to die right side up with Jesus. God still had a mission. And a lot of people think it's only about going to heaven. No, it isn't. It's about being involved with God's lambs here and following God here and getting the second chance and taking the second chance and serving God and enjoying God and maturing in God so you can be more ready for heaven when that day comes. Care for my sheep. Don't be comparing yourself with others. Don't be getting down in your mouth, you know, saying, well, what about them? You know, I'm the one that always has to pick up, carry the load. What about them? Jesus says, don't worry about them. You follow me. You do what I ask you to do. And I'll worry about them. The God of second chance. Resurrection, second chance. There's coming a day when we'll be in glory. And we're going to be there without sin. Some weeks ago, I talked with someone and told them that I was going to see someone who was terminal. And this person was a non-believer, so they kind of bristled. I don't know how you do that. You know, how do you go visit people that are terminal? I guess the answer to that is what Kubler-Ross used to say. Honey, we're all terminal. It's true, you know. We are all going to die. It's just no matter when and how. But the only way you can do that is because of the resurrection. Because of what we shared in the first service. That when you die, you go to the presence of God. And when you die, you're in the presence of God. And you're in a garden. And you're in heaven and in glory. And there's no sin. And Jesus is leading you. And there's living water. And there's beauty. And life as it was created to be. And that's the only way you can face life and death. Is knowing, hey, this is great, but it's going to get better. It's going to get better. Let's pray. Father, thank you for Easter. Thank you that there is eternal life, and it starts now when we accept Jesus. And if there's someone that doesn't know you, I pray that they would, even now, turn to you in prayer and say, Dear Lord Jesus, I need you. Come into my life. Fill me with your presence. Forgive me. Cleanse me. Use me. Help me be a part of the church, spreading your word. Father, help us overcome fear. You're the resurrection and the life. You're stronger than Satan. You're stronger than death. You've beaten them all. Help us to live above fear instead of under it. Bless these people. Give us all a good week. Help us to pay attention to you and then take care of your lambs. And we'll give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for your patience this morning. We're going to sing our traditional closing song. May the Lord mighty God. Don't forget the services for Jamie Friday. And don't forget, He is risen.
He's risen. Yeah,
Would you give a good honk for all the ladies that fix breakfast for us?